said, the API response we got from API, and but in the API response we are not getting a property called onMerit, because that's something we introduced in here. And so that's why we are putting it to false in here, so that in the display it won't show that text input minimum. So in here this side.
Okay, so what we have done so far is whatever in the app component JS, especially fetching and manipulating the states, we have taken out it out. But we have not yet wired the pieces. App component doesn't yet know about those things. That we are going to do later, but before that we will do some refactoring. We have this app and we have this component and styles outside. I will pick these styles and put it inside this. Okay, that's good. Let me check whether all the imports look good. Yeah, they look good. Okay. So the next we will also fetch the component and put it inside here. Okay. So that.
And we'll just try to keep your root folders simple and put it to a subfolder so that it's easy to read and easy to maintain.
Okay. The list is almost the same thing, so I just copy and paste the things again in here, just because as I change subs here, the imports could have changed. And also for the list item, I'm going to do the same thing.
In here, we have used a functional component rather than using a class component. You can actually use class components as well, but now React advise you not to use class component, because class components are not like sometimes it's create performance issues. Why we have to use class component is to maintain the state, but there's this new thing called React books that you can Google it and see. It's introduced with the new version. So now you can actually manipulate the state in functional component. So a better approach for you to follow from today onwards would be to always use functional components. So it's it'll be like next versions they are going to improve functional components more, and it's going to help you to improve your mobile application performance.
So let me copy paste the last piece of the item in here, and that's done. And coming back to our reducers. Here we had something fancy in here. Sorry, not the reducer. I'll go back to my actions. And this comes from a URL variable called base URL. So what we did is we created a folder called config, and we put all the config related variables in there. So let me do that quickly. This is the URL, but this time what we did is we only put the base URL in here, and in the actions we append the glossary, because related to that should be there, because base URL should always be in your config. I close everything here, that's done. So now we will try to refactor some of our app.js. This is very ugly, so now we know the total is happening somewhere else. No, not yet, but we know the fetch list item is happening somewhere here. So we can remove that. If I do that, I will not use experience. I'll keep it back here, but I'm really sorry about it, because or else nothing is more visible in here. So we know that we moved it already, we moved this function out. So we can remove that.
And we have taken
the at least out. Total we didn't do anything yet about it. Now our component is much slimmer,
and we don't have to use the constructor function anymore.
Yeah, and we also don't need this. We took the service dependency out of it, and we also don't need the constructor, because states are being made.
If you could undo it, I'll explain a small thing. In a constructor, you always have to do this one called super props, because you have to populate the proxy but from the, like in here, as I said earlier, everything is passed through props. Even for this, the properties are passed through another high order component, so you always have to spread it. That's why we have used this one, super props.
Okay. So now you see that our component app.js, the main component on the screen, has become very small. It's only knows about, still this is something bad in here, we will improve on it. And this is okay, because it's related to the UI, and this is more related to the UI. Okay. But we did more refactoring here, we created something called screens in here. Okay, so let me also move that thing there, because everything is going related to this into the app folder. And I have the name of grocery list.js, so that's the component we are extracting out. Okay, and let me copy paste this component.
Always try to keep your component for fewer lines, so that you don't have to go through all list of lines.
Okay, so it's the same thing, you know, component bit mount, get total, at list item. This is the function which calls the other action from in there, on list render, but we have some additional steps here, we will come to this later, okay? So now you see, the fetch list calls something called fetch list async. And if you see what really that was, it is calling the action from here. It's calling the one directly here, fetch list async. It doesn't know about it, and it knows about it through the properties that is being passed to it. So it even doesn't know it directly. It knows that something called this is available in its properties, and it's just invoking that property. So it doesn't directly know about the service call. Similarly, addItems also calls that same function through its property. Submit or save also does the same thing. So all these service call now doesn't, all this call doesn't know about the service actually. It's calling or invoking a property item on the prop syntax. So what happens after? Happens through these magic methods here. But we will come to this later, because we need to set up our store. That's the most important thing. Okay. So next thing which I'm going to create in here is called the store. Okay, but before this we need to combine all our reducers. That is something that we need to do. So I'll come back here, go to our reducers folder, and I'll create a file called index.js. And Vimukthi, you can maybe explain about combining.
Redux, for state management, there are many libraries that you can use for Redux. One is Redux, and another is Mobx. In Mobx, you can actually maintain different stores. But with Redux, you only can maintain one store. But a simple trick would be to create separate stores for separate, let's say, models, and then combine all them together and use it, and inject it to the application. So that's what we have done here. We have, you actually don't require to combine it in here, but while we have created this, one is because it will be easy for you to combine if you have any other stores. So one example would be like, if let's say we have another API where we are fetching prices for the item, then you can create a new reducer called prices.js, and then combine those two from here and create one large store.
It's like having multiple tables and then combining them to one bigger table. So it's easier for you to manage and look and read the application. You think it's like separate tables, but in reality it's just one big table. This tool, the combined reducer, take care of it for us. So we don't have to worry about it. Later when I show on the dev tools, I will show how the tree drops down. You know, to show clearly it's one main store, but you know, grocery is one item, price is one item. You know, they are like trees going down. So that way it's easier for you to manage the state. So what we do here is basically, you know, fetch our reducer, combine it, and then pass it back, you know. We pass it back as a combined reducer, and in the store we use this reducer. Okay, so coming back to our store, this is a folder which I have created already, and here is where we are going to use our reducer, and here is where we are hooking up all these things together. Okay, so if you see, we take that reducer which we created over here, which is called the root reducer. Sorry, we named it root reducer, but we are fetching it directly from there, the reducer's index.js. And this is the main magic method which we are Redux, tongue, Redux, and everything all connects together. So we call it configure store, and there is a function from Redux which is create store, and we pass this reducer. So this is a combined reducer. So we pass them all together here, and we can apply all our dev tools here, where the magic of thumb comes into play.
You always have to merge your stores before creating the store, so that you have one large store.
Okay. And also right now we are not passing any argument for thumb, because thumb can do more magic. But right now the magic that is done is more than enough for us.
This is called a middleware. So with Redux there are many middlewares that you can use. This one is thumb. Redux Saga is another, which you can use for asynchronous requests. And there could be service managers which we are going to introduce later on. And let's say there could be loggers. So everything will be interpreted in here through the method called apply middleware.
Okay. So we can improve our app.js, because as you all remember, we created something called grocery list, and we moved the grocery list here. So we can use the grocery list component directly. So in app.js, I'm going to reduce all this speed of code. Okay. So app.js is empty, and I paste, or maybe I'll copy everything from top, because you know the imports also would be useful for me. Okay, so what we are doing is, with Redux, we create a component called provide. He is going to pass all the properties from the top down to all the components. So this store will be injected directly to this provide.
Yeah. So in state management, like in here, we have used Redux, and there's a new thing called context API, which was released with React 16. Which you can actually use for state management as well. It's not that advanced like Redux, but it could be useful for simple things like, let's say, team management and saving user information. So you could use that for like state management. So that has a provider and a consume. So a provider is like, we always have to wrap the provider on the topmost component that we are going to use, so that it could be used by the consumers in the below. So if you go down the line, what you could do is like, you could invoke the consumer and use those properties.
So now, as he says, this consumer knows about this store. Okay, but still for him to know it, you know, we still have a magic method. That is what we call his map state to, the connect. And the connect has to do this thing, which is the props and the actions. So this is where everything hooks up together. So now from the state, we take the grocery list, because if you can remember, I'll close all the others here.
And we'll back to our state here. It has state and actions.
Yeah.
So connect is going to, what this function is going to do is, it's going to connect the state, which is in Redux store, to the consumer, which is the grocery list in here. And we are going to, this action is not always required. If you are manipulating the state, then we are going to map all the actions that, like action dispatches, through connect method. Okay. That's what this is.
Yeah, so he knows about the state. You know, the state right now has something called list and loading. So from state.grocery, if you remember this grocery is name of that reducer. So when we merged it, we gave the reducer a name of grocery. So store has the tree of grocery, tree has the other two states which we checked about here. Okay, so every single reducer can they have their initial state?
That's why we have set map state to props. So it explains what it does. What we are going to do is, we are going to map the state which is in Redux store to props of this component.
Yeah. Which is, so now this component knows about something called list, loading from the reducers and from action. So basically it knows about these three functions. So these properties are bound here, and that is why they are able to invoke. You know, this dot props has this function. Why? Because it's connected here. So this dot props has a list. This dot props has something called a list because it's connected here. But still, this method is not very efficient. We will see why later when we do reselect. But this is all of it. How they're putting happens, you know, to bring all together. But now if we see, the UI is not cleaner, except I don't like this add function in here. You know, it's still not something very related to this, and that's not very efficient. Apart from that, this is mostly good. And we have our reducers which handles their own responsibilities. It is again not the responsibility of the UI to handle stuff, some of the reducer does. Action types does all the actions that it needs to do. So all these responsibility to spread it out to what component or what element that needs to take care of.
Action types doesn't require to be like separated into another file. Why we have done it? Because we are reusing action types in two places. One is actions, one in reducers. Some developers actually define all these action types in actions, not in another folder. That's something you could actually.
That's your own decision. Yeah. That depends on your decision. Okay, so I think it's all about that, and we have two more slides to go, but this is all done. I hope everything went well with my copying and pasting. So we'll do a refresh, and something failed, though I'm not quite sure, or maybe the request is still going on. We can do, yeah, sorry. There's error. Okay. Yeah, there's an error, obviously. It says cannot read property length of undefined somewhere. Yeah.
So that, okay. You are reading state.
Anyway, that's not a related problem, but that's something I'd like to fix here as I noticed. Okay, and so it's all good. We'll again get back to the errors and see. It's very bad, you know, when there's no red screen and some error. Okay, I didn't do a yarn install yet, okay? My bad. So it doesn't know about the packages that were newly introduced?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah,
I think I didn't copy my packages also, okay. So.
Just do a yarn.
Yeah, no, it's okay.
We are going to add three packages. One is React Redux, the other is the Redux, and we are going to add Redux stuff. So what he's going to do is he's going to, the usual way would be to like type yarn add and then type these three package names, but he's going to paste it in the package JSON and then do a yarn install.
Okay, and there is like these packages here, but I'm going to add one more thing in here because this connects the dev tool that we are using. So this is needed for the dev tool, especially I can show you that. For this tool to work, to check all the Redux files, so I added that extension which is needed for that. Then we will do a quick yarn install. We will add all the new packages. Okay, that was quick and that's the speed of yarn, but if it was NPM, it would have taken a lot more time. I hope all the dependent packages are in there. Okay, it looks like. Okay. Yep. We'll get back here. Did it build? That's built. And we see a request was fired, and you can see from here, you know, actions going on. You know, there was the fetch. The fetch success was in here. I'll just zoom this out a bit. So there was the fetch list request. And when the fetch list check happened, it only changed the state into true. When fetch list success was there, the list was populated. So that's how Redux works. And you can even see your whole state in here. This is your grocery pin. You know, from the store, you have the grocery. Grocery has a list of three items, and loading is set to false. So you can
go to actions, then you can see the actions.
See, this is what we did. Like we have one thing called type, which is to identify which action dispatch, and we have something called payload, which we use to pass all the data which was used in the action.
So this was for this action and this was for this action. You can even record and play and see, you know, you can do a lot of steps with this dev tool, but you know, we will not get into the details of that. But you know, we have our app successfully listing, and we'll try to add and see whether, you know, the ad works. Let's say after Redux. So this item, this was fired and it got saved. So all good, you know. So it's the same map, but a lot improved. You know, if you when you get the access to the GitHub repository, just have a look. You can see a lot of improvements from what it was earlier to what it is now. For example, you will see this glossary list component has been reduced drastically.
Can you go back to the action? Payload is that kind of like a in here, why we pass it as payload is it's kind of an industrial practice to name it. This could you can actually name this list, but with payload you can why we named it payload first because it's an industrial practice that we use for action dispatches. That way you can like you can simply get the payload and then destruct the this item and then simply add it to the
manipulate it the way you want.
Okay.
So now we try to add, you know, there was an add request that went through because this was something simple, there is nothing related to the state happen. But save also was a simple request, nothing related to the state happen. But you know, on coming back, you know, it changed to the state. You know, there was a payload here. In the diff we can see, you know, the new ID is pasted instead of the new item. It put the new ID in there. So we can debug our work here easily. So that is with Redux, and now you can see all the fetch related stuff is reduced.
One good thing you could do is like install this extension called Redux DevTools and just go to the websites like Bitbucket, Bitcloud. All of them have used Redux and Redux Tank, and they have exposed the Redux.
You can see a lot of things that happens, you know, you can see a lot of magic happening around, and that will be really
you can understand what how it uses the Redux store and how actions are fired and how it's manipulated.
Any questions, or if you are not following along, I know, you know, sometimes hanging on with this sometimes harder, but try to follow along because by the end of it you would have some knowledge, but you can go home and investigate more on top of it where you will get to understand the code basically. This is a very basic cap. Try to play around with as much as possible, then you can improve your knowledge on React. Okay? So what we have done is we have removed all the dependencies from this out related to the services. One bad thing we still have here is getTotal, which we have, you know, solved next using something called reselect, but not the purpose of it. Reselect can do more magic than that, but we'll show you some power of it and but we'll explain you the major power of it. The next bad thing is, you know, fetch is everywhere. It's here, it's here, it's everywhere. So we need to take that off, you know. This should not know about fetch basically. It should only know what service is going to do what, but fetch is somewhere else. You know, it's not his responsibility to take care of fetch. So that is the next improvement that we are going to work on.
And this is a very basic way to do it, and it's a very bad way to do in industrial applications. Because most of the time, the results you are getting through API has to be manipulated to be used in your application. And sometimes you might have to, let's say it's a public API and it's you have no control over it. And you use different names for the properties. And so those kind of stuff, we have to have a normalizer functions, which you are going to manipulate all the data coming from that and like send it to the store. And there could be error handlers as well. So for all that, we are going to create a thing called Service Manager, which we are going to use to dispatch all the API calls. And we are going to we are not going to introduce what normalizers do in here, and we are not going to introduce error handlers as well because it's we don't have much time, and it will be something hard for you to understand at this point. But we'll introduce what Service Manager could do. And we'll implement it in here.
Yeah, we'll do a reselect first and then we'll do a reselect is something quick that we'll finish in like 10 minutes. And we'll take like 20 minutes for the service manager, so we have some time for that. So we can plan to finish things by 8, 8:10. So that we know that it's taking a lot of time. So but we'll try to make it quick, okay? So the next thing is I'll add something called yarn reselect. In the meantime, you can explain what reselect does and how it's useful for us.
Reselect is mainly used to let's say our store get manipulated. In here we have one is that adding a new list item. So in there the store is going to be manipulated, and when the store is manipulated, there could be functions that use the state. In here we have this thing called get total. So the total is calculated by the entities which are in store. That's the list item content. So this is a very simple way to calculate the quantity, but we could use a reselect which is going to dispatch automatically for a state manipulation. Let's say like the new like on success it's going to add a new item to the list, so that is a change in the state. So the reselect is going to fire automatically, and it's going to give like a, we could use reselect to get a manipulated data or a more reformed data, like in here getting the total. But this is the simplest integration you could do. One advance would be as I explained here, we could have multiple stores. In here we have used grocery list, and there could be another one with products and product prices. So if we have any integration between those two, let's say in the grocery list we are going to add milk powder and the quantity is going to be 50, and in the other store we have the items and the prices. So with reselect we can actually access those two, and we could create a selector function to calculate that price and show it in the front. That you can actually do it in the component itself, but it's not a good approach, because then you'll have to dispatch actions manually.
There's a moment of fun. It's not the time to talk about milk powders. The idea is bad, talk about milk powders. Okay. All are following the parliament session, right? Okay. So basically, the select, the create selector, what it's going to do is, this is basically going to know about the state. You know, that will show how it knows about the state. Right now, looking at this function, it knows about the state somehow. And it can get the list of get the grocery list here. Okay, so it knows the state. We have destructured the state here. So state has grocery has list. So it knows about the list and it returns the list. This is basically a return statement here. But this is where the special reselector function is happening. This reselector says that he needs the grocery list, and he also needs to do some action. But as Vimukthi explained, it can take not only from the same store, it can take from different multiple other stores, and it can take them together and it can do a function together. And it's going to be very efficient. How? This, for example, if we go back to our screens component or the grocery component, the main one over here, this function is not very efficient. That's here to promise.
What?
Sorry, I was on the wrong meeting. Okay. So if you go back to screens and take this, this function is not very efficient. Okay? He keeps rendering every time when there is a state change. But this selector, what he can do is he can keep a memory of, you know, whether the data which he actually inputs has changed. If it is not changed, he is not going to execute, he is going to return back from the memory that he has. So that way he is efficient. He doesn't have to loop through every single time unless there is something related to him is changed. Unless that, he is never going to execute that. So that way the reselect is going to be very beneficial for you. So right now we have this reselect function over here. So the next thing is we need to introduce to the grocery list that he needs to know about the this thing. So what we are going to do is we are going to make some inputs. I'll copy my whole inputs and then bring it out here, because I'll make sure that this selector was imported. I'm quite sure somewhere here. Okay, then here in the match case to props, what we are going to do is we are going to take and introduce him to that function.
So this is more like a, you could actually write that function in here. Like you can write a function called calculate total and then simply pass the state and do the same thing that we did. But the advantage with selectors is you can add more state to one and then manipulate it, so that you don't have to do it and you could actually reuse it everywhere. There could be another screen where you are maybe just showing the past content like grocery list items. In there you could actually reuse that selector function
and doesn't calculate again, you know, it uses from the memory. So now we introduce this method to him, you know, this method to him. What we can tell you is, you know, you don't need to calculate anymore. And we can tell him, you know, the total is now available in your props directly. So we can say this dot props dot total directly, because, you know, this is binding that function to the props of total. So that's in there. So what we can do is we can eliminate this function out. So So that's anymore not needed. So I hope that's all about reselect.
You have the access.
I didn't get
it.
So that should be good. We will try to
see here. He has access to the model.
I'll do the answer. This will be good.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Here he has, without destructuring, he has simply referred to the props object and then not destructable. It's okay to do it, but better would be to destructure it. If you do ESLint integration and if you import practices by RBNB, then they restrict this one. They're going to show error. They're always going to say use destructuring because it's the more efficient way to do it.
Yeah, we were planning to do ESLint, but we don't have the time to do the ESLint, so we purposely put some errors here and there to show you that ESLint shows those errors. But unfortunately, we don't have the time to do that, but if possible, we will update the GitHub with the ESLint
integration, and one would be with the ESLint integration, so we'll add steps as if possible, and then one with fixes.
I think there's something wrong with okay, the survey is not running. Let me do that. Okay. The cooking is okay, and now there seems to be an issue. This one in the blue. So, maybe I named something wrong. Let me check upon that. This is selectors and
you have help.
Okay, it should be glossary.js. Are we ready to speak to you? Okay, this is okay. So we do
you could actually use one selector file, but this is a good approach to follow because you'll definitely have to create many selectors and many reducers, so for each reducer, better have another selector.
This time it was empty and everything loaded, and you can see the total not happening for the same reason that we didn't do a passing. Okay, so this needs to be passing. Okay. So with that, we finished reselect, and we will quickly start upon the service manager, because service manager is the most important part that we thought we will pass into you, because right now what we are doing is we are trying to create everything new here. For example, this action knows about a lot of things. It knows about what fetch does, you know, what the basic URL is, and everything related to it, it knows about it. So we need to eliminate that. So what with service managers, we are going to do the same thing. Okay. So what we will do is, I'll create something and I'll explain them along the way.
Here we have to use error. You don't necessarily have to use payload. It was intended to show you that you could use any name that you want. But industry of practice is to always use payload so that it's common.
Okay. Okay. So, in here, I'm going to add some more related stuffs. One is something called service. Okay, so we will create a folder for service up here. Okay, and I'll add something called apiservice.js. And here we are going to put a big chunk of code, which we will quickly explain it what that does. And now we are trying to migrate. Okay. So this, you remember that in grocery-list.js, when saving, we always set this headers. But we are keeping our default contents on the top, you know, the related headers that we might have. This is basically an API service which knows everything about an API. Okay. So this is the place where we feel that this should be there. and we construct, we are always giving a base URL, because we take the base URL out of it, because related service should know about it. So this knows only about a base URL where it should invoke it. Then we have a method called get and a method called post. But get does it, it calls the fetch function that we have written in already. The post also calls the fetch function, but you know, only difference thing that the post have is it has a body, whereas the get doesn't have a body.
Okay. You could actually create one to put, delete, whatever API
methods fetch that you make. Okay. What the fetch does is, it is looking whether we have any query params. If there is any query params, you know, it is appending all those query params like question mark, foo equal bar, ampersand foo equal bar, something like that. That is what this line does. Okay. Then option basically merges every option that needs to be passed into fetch. Fetch visits two parameters, the URL and the option. So basically it merges the default header, but you can use these options to override the headers, and it puts the method type, whether it's get, post or something. Okay.
This will come handy, the options part. Let's say in here we are not handling we are not sending authentication tokens, or we are not going to use any authorized API calls. So, but we could, where we could use options would be that instance, like in that specific API service, you could actually inject
an authorization header, so which can be merged in here. Okay. Then this basically does is, you know, converts the body into a JSON.string. Basically, if you notice here, that was very ugly. We do a JSON.string in here. But now it's related to
here.
So it's related to here. Then we put it into the fetch function, which basically takes the endpoint, you know, and also the options.
We have used console log so that we can see if the those address flows are deployed. You can actually remove those when you are deploying it to the production environment.
And we have certain errors here, different errors that can be thrown. Depending on each status code we are throwing an error, you know, you can handle multiple status code in here. For example, like for a validation error code, or you know, unsupported media type, or whatever, you can handle all these things here. Finally, if everything is okay, we DC, like we get the JSON body and we return it back. Okay. What I'm going to do quickly is create all these errors, because we have created them as methods. So rather than creating in here, I'll just create the error folder in here. I think it's errors, and I'll
you necessarily doesn't have to know what this actually does. What you could do is simply use the like files we have already implemented, and then build your application upon it. So
I copy pasted all the errors so that, you know, it's in here rather than we create one by one, so what we can quickly see. I created all these errors. So basically array is just like an exception that you would do in any other languages. Okay.
This will be very useful if you are adding things like loggers. Let's say for specific errors, if you want to send it to an API, or maybe save it in a local file, you could use these classes that we have defined.
Okay. And so errors is done, the basic API setup is done. So the next thing is we create the related API service, which is the grocery service. So we come back into our services, and we will create our groceryservice.js. So now this is going to be look very beautiful, you know, because everything is abstracted out into the API service. So what this does is,
and build a new service just for the grocery.
Okay. But this does is, he has the API endpoint, the end part of it. He doesn't know about the base URL. Okay. So he knows something, but he gets an API service. API service is this API service. So he gets an instance of that API service. And if there is a get, you know, he basically says this dot API, basically this person, and get something. This get method is already in here.
A simpler method would be to extend the API service we have declared there, and then write this one. But we are going to use this special thing called service manager, which we'll explain as we go.
And service manager is really beautiful. Yeah. When we do that code, you can see how efficient that is going to be. So now this is more easy and reader friendly, and rather than you don't need to know about the API service and anything of that sort. So this is created. The next thing I think we'll be creating is the service manager itself.
Is this Redux?
No. This is just for API calls. So you can actually use this even without Redux. We are now going to introduce what service manager, thing called service manager. What it's going to do is it's going to register all the services we need in one place, and with that approach we can actually do things like error handling injectors or thing called are you aware of things like normalizer functions? A normalizer, what it does is it could manipulate the data we are getting from API and put it to a simpler form or a form that we require. So a service manager will help you to declare all the services you require and inject those like manipulating stuff in there. So yeah.
Okay. So we are almost nearing completion. So to give you the idea, this is the service manager class. Okay. This does a lot of things, but I would like to take some step and explain it. When constructing, it says, you know, it constructs these objects called instance and factories. And it says, you know, this is not writable to make it immutable. And it says it's enumerable, but, you know, gives some values and basically connects them to these things, you know. That is what it is describing those things. So we have something called factories and something called instances. If you have known about dependency injection, we don't always create a new object. So let's say in our case, very clearly, the API service, sorry, the grocery service depends on API service. So if a grocery service has to exit, it needs an API service to be created. So a service manager will know that, you know, when creating, that is the factory, you know, how to create an API service or how to create a grocery service. So service manager would know to create an API, grocery service, you always need an API service. So it knows that dependency and it knows to create those steps. And within instances, what it does is, if it has already created one object of grocery service, it will reuse that. Because creating objects again and again can be costly. So it stores that instance in there, and it will reuse those objects after creation. So this method does that, but this method will always take a name and how that method can be created. So it basically does is, you know, puts the name, it checks some validations. If everything is good, it puts the factory into factory and the name into name. So right now name can be undefined, but instantiate is where it basically creates something. So when creating, these are all validations in here, so that we don't have to worry. This method is safe to invoke, is defined below here. But what it does is, you know, whether there is a recursive dependency, something like, you know, grocery service depends on API service, but API service again depends on grocery service. So then it can't create it, you know, there is a recursive dependency. So this validates a recursive dependency. If not, it pushes it and it creates, you know, it uses the factory method and creates that object. So now it has that instance. And if, you know, if it could not create that instance, it throws a service error. If it successfully creates it, it keeps a memory of that instance.
Again,
so the next time,
this is a very advanced thing. So you don't have to understand what it does. Simply reuse it. If you want, just go through the code and try to understand.
See, once when we ask for that service, what it does here is, it checks whether it already has that instance. If it does it, if it has it, it returns that instance. If not, it basically creates that instance. And the factory method knows how to create that instance. So that is what the service manager does. So the next thing that we are going to do is, we are going to register the services.
Why we created a thing called service manager is because we explained earlier that we can apply middlewares to Redux. So this is going to be a middleware that we develop, separate one, like Redux thumb, which is going to help us in invoking services directly to Redux thumb. Not like you can simply create something like a library called the library called Axios. It's used for like API requests. You can use it, but this is going to help you a lot when you are using things like normalizers and error handlers. Simply you can inject that to the Redux thumb, and then Redux thumb knows what this like. There's a thing called service manager. So from Redux thumb you can invoke this and use it.
Okay. So this basically registers every single service. Basically, it creates a new service manager object. If it is the first time, you know, it's being loaded. So in app.js, we load this, and it basically registers an API service. So when registering, it says, you know, you please pass this base URL, which is from the config, and that is the base URL for that. Okay. So it created it with its dependency. Now, service manager gets the API service from the service manager because it's already registered with him. So he basically gets that again Now he has the API, it doesn't create it again, it knows that it's already created, so it takes it and it creates a grocery service. Now he knows about API service and grocery service about it.
This is where you can inject the other services like normalizer services to that.
It basically manages the whole dependency, the service management. Okay. So that's done. So we need to tell app.js, you know, to use this guy. So we go back into our app.js here. And we basically give him the... So right now, configure store doesn't take anything because Redux comes needs to know about it. So right now, we call this register services function which we created right now here. I took the register as register services, so that is why it's called register services here. And this service manager we pass into configure store, which is in the store.js. So now store.js additionally knows about something else, so which we will update quickly.
So what we are going to do is we are getting a thing called service manager. So we are going to get it and we are going to
pass it as a Redux thunk middleware in there. So now Redux thunk also knows about this guy called service manager. So now the time comes for us to go back to our reducers, sorry, not reducers, actions, and eliminate the fetch, because you know we know about fetch right now, because you know we know the people who know about fetch. So that what we are going to do here is we'll take this whole thing, and you can see this is a whole line which takes till line number 55, and right now it's reduced drastically. Okay, so what happens is with thunk, earlier it was only dispatch, it only did dispatch, but now it has two other functions. Now it also injects the service manager into this.
Get set is a default middleware that you get with Redux thunk. So if in any case if you want to access state, you can use this one, get state. So what it does is it will send you the Redux store. And in some cases, you can actually let's say you are going to append the current list and then send the new one. So what you could do is access that state and then append the new item you created and send the entire list to the API if it requires.
So basically now he knows about the service manager. Right now we removed all the fetch that was here, and what we have done is from the service manager we directly call get. So from the service manager we get the grocery service, and from the grocery service we simply say get grocery list, and he doesn't know anymore about the fetch library. So it's the responsibility of grocery list. Okay.
Yeah. So this way you can actually we have created API service. So if you want to use Axios, then you don't have to modify it in many places. What you could do is simply modify the API service and implement Axios or any third party library you require.
Okay. And there are a few dependencies which I added, so I'll just replace this dependency called merge to merge the object in the fetch. So I'll add that dependency, so that's in there. This is the merge library which merges objects.
It comes with Lodash library. Lodash is mainly for array manipulations. Pro and Google latency, it's very useful in advanced applications if you want to manipulate arrays.
Okay, I'll do a yarn install to get my Lodash merge, and I'll hopefully start and the application runs. Okay, and then we'll do a quick 5-minute wrap up, and with that we can find out stuff, but I hope you know the project runs.
We were actually hoping for a cloud which they are for React and React Native piece. We were going to teach you advanced stuff. We understand this cloud is new to React, so we are really sorry about it. That's why we specifically sent in the meetup that we require cloud which is aware of what React and React Native piece.
Okay, so now to quickly see all the code, I'll say close all. Now if you see the screen doesn't know anything. If you see the first app, you know it was so bad. Now the screen only works with the UI stuff. It doesn't know about anything else except you know these function which magically connects us. And this reselect is doing a helpful hand for us in calculating the total. So that's something great. Then apart from that, everything is dispatched by actions. And if we get into actions they doesn't know about anything related to the services. They use the service manager to get the dependent service. They make the calls. So if we get into service, service is beautifully structured and it's very easy to read and easy to maintain. Where API service is doing bulk of the load, where this and the service manager is a little harder code to understand, but if you read through it, you know, you will eventually catch it up. Okay? And our app.js is very beautifully maintained, and our reducers are doing the necessary steps that they need to do. So it's the same app which we developed in the beginning, but there is a lot of changes. This works peacefully, and from our Redux dev tools, we know, you know, the actions are firing correctly. And if we try to add, there was this action which fired to add a new item and it dropped in the fake item. We can put something in here and we can put a quantity. We say save. The action to save fired, the action to success fired. So everything went peacefully. So I have done the job of copying and pasting correctly. Luckily, but remember the components. So to wrap up things, just to give you the idea how you can make a benefit out of this. That's very important because it's not something that you went through. Okay? Use the GitHub as much as possible. It will be just a 5-minute prep. Use much as possible. This is the React init code. Okay? We didn't do anything after that. Okay? We were trying to work on error handlers, but we'll update that later. Okay? But if you switch the branch to 01 simple implementation, this has the code which was ugly code. Okay? Just have a look at it. Okay? See how ugly, you know. Because mostly we have seen junior developers or interns working with us do this. But they don't understand, they don't see the outer picture, they don't see working with different developers, you know, why things should be separated into their own responsibilities. They don't see this. You know, debugging that application is very hard. And for another person...
Even we started that way.
And we started that way. Okay, obviously me. Okay, and I'm still learning and improving my React Native. So, we don't see the benefit of it. You know, testing that grocery list component is very easy. If you use something called Jest snapshots, it's very easy. Jest snapshots, you can pass properties, you can pass different properties and see your snapshot was formed correctly. Okay.
It'll help you in cases like if you are building a library which is which has component which can be reused in other projects. Then it'll be like, let's say you change a component and if you added a new parameter. Props, then it will show that there's a change in the snapshot, so something you will have to consider. That's a very easy tool. There are other testing tools like Jesmin, which is an insight, which is developed by Airbnb. So you could go through those.
Just imagine, without the props, you have the service inside the component, and you are trying to do a Jest snapshot. It should know about the service call. So, you know, during the test, it tries to make a service call, which is a fail. Okay, it never happens. You know, so now this is separated. Service is different. So that's much easier. Now, another thing which I would recommend is just go here and try to read the commits. You know, everything is squashed into one commits. So implement simple app to Redux time. So you can just go into this thing and see the diff, you know, what really happened. As I'm on a low resolution, I can't see that properly. But you can see that if you know what things changed, how the code evolved to come to a better state is something that you can see and understand for yourself. And the next thing what we did in here, I'll just reduce this thing, which is not yet completed. We were trying to do that. Let me do a reset and do this. Okay. So,
because the libraries we have built with like so many codes. Okay. So, because it especially catered to our product, so that